Hey there, this is Monique, and today I'm here to talk about the ladder of inference. This is one of those things that you can put into a search engine and find lots and lots of fantastic versions of the ladder of inference. And it was originally developed by Chris Argyris, and I think that was maybe back in the 70s. And what he proposed, and many of us have celebrated heartily as a fantastic way to look at the way we perceive the world, is that we have a pool of available data in any given experience we have. And so right now, as you're sitting and listening, talking to you, there are probably walls around you or trees around you or something, and your brain is taking in all kinds of data from the world around you. And it filters out the data that it decides to pay attention to, but it's still monitoring that other data. So, for example, if all of a sudden a pencil that was nearby started to levitate, your brain would say, hey, something's going on over there. We need to shift our attention and check that out, even if you're not aware that at this moment there's a pencil in your field of vision. So step one in the ladder of inference is that there is data all around us, and that we, from the very first nanoseconds of our experiences of the world, have filtered out a huge amount of that data. And one of the ways that you can playfully check this out is if you were to buy a new car or bicycle or something like that, you will notice other cars or bicycles just like the one you just bought, and you'll think, were there always so many of these around? So that's just because now it's something you're paying attention to. And where we put our attention is a really, really critical part of our experiences, and we'll get into that in future videos in much more depth. And we also add our own meaning. We have culture and our personal experiences. There's also the greater context in which everything is occurring. So without realizing it in any given situation, we're bringing everything that was into what is. I will sometimes talk about ghosts of relationships past. I might be in a relationship present, intimate or not, and be thinking consciously or not about other relationships and how this relationship is like those or not like those. And so I'm bringing meaning from the past into my current moment. And then what ends up happening is as I've taken in that data and added my own context and meaning, I then consciously or subconsciously decide what I think and feel. And so sometimes you might hear somebody say, well, you made me feel mad. Actually, it's not possible for you to make them feel a certain way. They can create data that can invite them to feel angry, but it's actually them processing that experience that makes them feel angry. And then they draw conclusions for what they think and feel. So if, for example, you and I interacted and I'm angry, I very likely have drawn some conclusions that you chose the behavior or the event that has invited me to feel angry. And so then I might do something. I might hang up the phone on you. I might say, I'm no longer available to write that report or whatever it is. But all of that is happening in a way that if we take the power to pause and ask myself, am I aware of what data I filtered out? Am I aware of what ghosts I'm bringing forward? Am I aware of the greater context on how I'm treating myself and what else is going on in my life? I might be able to be more compassionate, ask more questions. And the ladder of inference is occurring internally and externally. So if you go to my website, you'll see my version of the Ladder of Inference. And what I invite you to do to slow down your progression of going up the steps is to check in with myself, and see if I can notice those steps occurring. Check in with others. Ask people, you know, how are you doing? That's one of the things my kids will do if I bring some burdens from work home. And I'm moving about my day, they'll say, "Hey, Mom, how are you?" And that reminds me that I'm probably scurrying up that ladder and not being present, and deciding to have a wonderful evening with my kids. Because it's precisely being present that shifts the focus away from the past and the future that I'm messing with up in my brain and lets me be here in this moment, which then lets me let go of agendas. And it ignites my curiosity if I'm present, what's possible for me to create from this moment, right here. And in the case, for those of us that sometimes come home and aren't bringing our best selves home, I don't know about you, but I want my best self to be at home. I want to foster the most powerful creation and connection with those that are in my home with me. And so bringing myself to present lets me tune in to the world in my home. I also want to bring my best self to work. And so if something hasn't gone well in the morning for me, I spilled my tea and I had to scrape my windshield because it was cold outside, or I missed my bus, or I was too cold to bike ride and I really, really wanted to bike ride, or too hot to bike ride. It's important to when I get to work, also do the same thing, check in, be present, let go of the past and the future and just say, what do I want to create today in this day, in this moment, and tune in to my team around me. And then once I've become present and become mindful of that journey of the ladder of inference, I'm able to shift my perspective and really absorb the people that are in front of me, and receive what they have to offer, and then be able to share something from me that is something that they are also able to readily understand. And it helps me get out of fix mode. Instead, it puts me into create mode. And so I really invite you to consider that the ladder of inference is one of the greatest tools that you can implement in every moment of your life. One of the things that will make you more effective with the ladder of inference is to understand that all of us humans are an interaction of our biology and our experiences. And so taking a look at some of the ways of being human can be super helpful with the ladder of inference. If you're not familiar with DISC quadrants, D-I-S-C, I invite you to also get on your search engine and look at DISC quadrants. See if you can determine what your DISC quadrant is. Tony Robbins has a free DISC assessment that I find very informative when I'm working with my clients and fostering deeper connections with those I love. And take a look at your Enneagram style and see if you look at these different ways of being human. This is not about prescribing a way that is and is unchangeable. This is a way about fostering curiosity, inviting a cosmic chuckle. In the case of DISC quadrants, my primary quadrant is that I'm a decisive driver. So I love to make checklists and check things off and drive the work forward. That doesn't mean that I'm not capable of promoting ideas like I am in these videos, or analyzing countless bits of research and coaching clients to heighten my ability to explain some of these tools and concepts in a way that works for people. And let's see, that was cautious analyzer. Oh, and it doesn't mean that I can't be in touch with my stabilizing supporter, to check in with those around me. As a matter of fact, knowing that I can get into a very driver-like mode, a very decisive-like mode, reminds me how important it is to consider how I might bring a more stabilizing support or part of my personality forward. The other thing in DISC quadrants is that you might want to make sure that the teams that you have around you, whether they're personal or professional, have a balance of those quadrants. Because when you are going up the ladder of inference individually and as a team, sometimes it's because you're not looking at a whole picture. The Enneagram, since there's 9 types, I can't describe quite as succinctly in this video, but they are not prescriptive. They are simply ways to look at some of our more stable personality traits that are part biology and our neurochemistry, and also our personality types that have come from our experiences, many of them in our early formative years. And in the diagram of the ladder of inference, this is that greater context. It also is part of who and how you are that in my example of the ladder of inference talks about your emotional guidance. And there are some core ways of being and feeling and passions that you bring that shoot you alongside the ladder of inference. You're not adding meaning, you are fulfilling purpose. Again, talks for longer videos, and I invite you to reach out and connect with me so that we can continue to dive deeper any one of these concepts, paradigms, and tools is best explored experientially, getting together with small groups in ad hoc workshops or finding workshops near you. At present, I live in Bellingham, Washington, and there are incredible organizations here. Excellence Seminars International, Excellence Northwest, Be More You, Nonviolent Communication, and these are fantastic places for you to seek out. I'm sure there are some near you. And Conscious Leadership Group down in California. If you are part of an organization that uses these tools and concepts and has experiential workshops, please let me know so I can share yours as well. What I've come to understand is putting this stuff in your head is lovely. That's a great place to start. But experiencing it, interacting with other people, trying it out, observing it, is where you really get what I call an aligned and cellular understanding of how this stuff works. So enjoy the ladder of inference, we'll talk more about this in most of the videos, because the way that you are adding meaning to everything is critical. It's a critical part of your awareness in being able to forgive yourself, celebrate yourself, forgive others, celebrate others, and create the life that you want and the peace on this planet that I crave. Thank you for listening.